Let's go ahead and get started, everybody. We're going to go ahead and get things started. Morning, everybody. Thanks for coming. So we are going to get things going here with just a few slides and kind of an introduction, and then we'll get to the discussion and introduction of our panelists that we're lucky to have with us discussing this topic this morning. So thanks all for coming. So we have pretty much everybody here, which I'm glad about, that is generally involved in the management of our surgical patients, from the surgeons, residents, fellows, but also a lot of the operating room staff, the nurses, anesthesia staff, and scrub techs, and also a lot of clinic staff and clinic technicians. So I think this is going to be an interesting discussion for everybody. Hopefully everyone is okay and willing to voice their opinions, and we're looking for a lively discussion this morning on simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery, which can be a little misleading in the terminology. So I want to just go through the terms and kind of tell you exactly what that means, or what I think it means. But probably the better way to describe it is actually immediately sequential bilateral cataract surgery. And I didn't really think about that until yesterday. One of the residents, who I'm not going to name, but came up to me and was asking about this grand rounds, and was trying to figure out how you get both microscopes and both surgeons over the patient at the same time. Or whether you do one with the right and one with the left, like Dr. Olson said. So even though, you know, for simplicity's sake and to match what they call it in the literature, we're going to call it SBCS, or simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery, it's probably better described as immediately sequential. So this is cataract surgery performed on the same patient in the same operative setting on one eye, shortly followed by the second eye. So that's what we're talking about. Now, there are certain scenarios where that is performed commonly, and it's not really controversial, and that's not what we're going to be discussing today. So these simultaneous or immediately sequential surgeries have historically been performed either primarily in developing countries or pediatric patients or patients requiring general anesthesia, and so that's not what we're going to be talking about. We're going to be talking about this in you know, quote unquote normal patients with bilateral visually significant cataracts who don't have any of the customary indications to want to have this done on both sides at the same time. But there we can look at lessons applied from the literature where those patients who have had it for other indications have been looked at. So what we're going to do is kind of start off with the everyone participating and helping us come up with a list of the good and bad, pros and cons to simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery. And then we're going to move on to a discussion with our panelists. And so we're happy to have our panelists here. So I'm going to introduce them one at a time. So Dr. Ambadi, he is someone who incorporates simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery into his practice at times, and he has some experience with that, and so we're be interested to hear his thoughts and his experiences on that. And likewise, Dr. Crandall does a fair amount in certain settings as well, and so both of them have experience with these patients, and we'll be interested to hear their thoughts. Dr. Jacobson is the chief of the Division of Medical Ethics and Humanities, and you guys know him from our previous discussions on ethics here, and so we're happy to have him to sort of frame this discussion. And Dr. Mamelis and Dr. Olson are both well qualified to participate in the discussion, also both as a result of their roles on the editorial boards of various ophthalmic journals, but also they both helped shape the most recent preferred practice pattern put out by the American Academy of Ophthalmology on cataract in the adult eye. So we're happy to have them to help discuss this as well. So those of you who are at Resident Alumni Day may remember participating, the seven of you who participated in my poll. We're going to try this again. There's way more than seven people here, so we have to get more than seven. So we're going to start off. So the way this works is if you pull up on your phone, I know you're all going to be playing on your phone anyway, so you might as well just make this part of the morning. If you pull up on your mobile phone or your laptop, this website, so pollev.com/Moran, or you can use a text message, in which case your standard text rates will apply, but you text to this number, 22333, and then you text the number that corresponds to your answer choice. And so this poll is basically, do you think simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery is a reasonable thing to offer? And this is sort of all patients considered. So to all bilateral cataract patients, to most, to some, all the way down to not even your dog. And we'll come back to that in just a second while you guys are, maybe I'll leave it up so you can see the numbers. So if you those of you who did this with the website, if you leave that website up, there's going to be a few more polls throughout the morning. So as I switch to the new poll, it'll automatically refresh on your screen. So just leave that website up if that's how you're doing it. I don't really think this is going to be a problem, but if we get to 40 responses, it'll tell the 41st person that we're full. I don't know. We have 26. Okay, so we're kind of getting there, and it looks like there's at least a sizable percentage that say that this is rarely, at least so far, this is only the rare patient with bilateral cataracts who may benefit from this. And so we'll see. We'll come back to this and see if the discussion this morning helps sway anybody. You can keep voting, by the way. We'll pull that up in a second. Yeah, so it doesn't sway the other. Yeah, that's right. You know, I don't know how to do that. So maybe, yeah. Well, then you have to memorize what the number is that you want to vote for. So if you do it on the website, then yeah. But if you have to text in the number, then maybe I could just write the numbers on a slide or something. Sorry. People are getting swayed by the majority here. Okay. So I don't know what everyone's experiences are with simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery, but what I want to do at this point is just take a few minutes to take suggestions from anybody and everybody about what the thoughts are on the pros and cons of not quite yet, because when we turn this off, we'll have you, that way it's not shining in your face. Yeah. So we're gonna go just whoever wants to throw something out there one at a time. We'll whatever you think the pros of simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery are versus the cons, so the goods and the bads. So Dr. Crandall. Is Randy in here?
So that's otherwise known as a dartboard. It just kind of threw up. Pretty simple. Well, not quite. It wasn't quite that bad, but
For refractive.
Many may remember when Randy wrote an editorial 7 years ago, where looking at the data, putting in a 19.5 or 20.5, I don't remember what the number was still 90% correct, 95%.
Yeah, if you gave plus or minus, if you gave yourselves a fairly broad range, which was what our broad range was, that there was a certain power in regards to a fairly standard patient that got you just about as good as result as what biometry was at that time.
And then the big fear that everybody talks about, even though it's statistically not common, is endophthalmitis.
Right.
There's been one or two reported cases in the Indian literature, bilateral endophthalmitis, and that of course would be devastating. One of the big, the real fear that I worry most about, if you figure out the statistics on that, which isn't too high, is not bilateral but TAS.
Yeah.
Toxic anterior segment syndrome. That could be a real, that's a reason why when we talk about one of the things we do, what the things that we do differently in this subset of patients to help at least avoid that possibility. And then another really big one, and it depends on it where you live, is that the second eye is only reimbursed half price.
Mm-hmm.
And that's and that has been studied in Canada and in the provinces where the reimbursement was half on the second eye, then the number of cases done compared to the parts of Canada where it was reimbursed same as both eyes,
yeah,
was considerably less. I must admit we didn't accept that paper at least initially, but I think
so that would seem to be a pretty big incentive for some surgeons to is financial.
Yeah.
So Dr. Crandall's point. So sorry, we didn't have the microphone at first, and I don't know, maybe you guys would be able to sit up here without the screen shining directly in your face. I'm not sure. Jeff, do you want to try it out?
I think they're okay.
So Dr. Crandall's point to begin with is that historically, I mean, this hasn't even been a thing that we think about, because with intracapsular cataract extraction and even extracapsular, the recovery is so long, and there's prolonged corneal edema, induced astigmatism, and basically a long period of delayed visual recovery that, I don't even think about this, you wait, at least initially, a couple of months before the second eye, and even with extra cap and then early phaco, I mean, or even now with phaco, at least a week or two before the second eye. And so it's only been with the development of small incisions and phaco emulsification and pretty quick visual recovery that we're even to the point where we can talk about this as a possibility, because there's just, in the vast majority of patients, there's not a delay in recovery. And then your point with TAS is that with endophthalmitis, I mean, it's rare. TAS is rare also, but with endophthalmitis, it's more of a sporadic event where TAS has much more of a likelihood of being an epidemic almost, where it happens in quick succession. And if that's the case on your OR day when you're doing unilateral cases, then you'll have one eye of a lot of patients who have TAS. But if you happen to be doing bilateral cases, then
right,
it might be both eyes of the same patient. And, right, and that outcome can be just as bad as endophthalmitis.
Can you explain the difference between TAS and endophthalmitis for those who might not know?
Can we, Dr. Mamelis, we have an expert in here. I don't think they want to hear my thoughts.
Yeah.
This is our course for 20 years. Right?
Yeah.
20 years worth. You know, basically, TAS is a sterile anterior segment inflammation following cataract surgery. It's by definition non-infectious. Sometimes the symptoms and the signs will overlap between infectious endophthalmitis and TAS, but TAS stands for toxic anterior segment syndrome. And basically, TAS people will be seen within 12 to 48 hours after surgery, so an immediate onset of inflammation. They'll have corneal edema, they'll have a lot of inflammation in the eye, they'll have fibrin in the eye, and they'll have blurred vision, usually not so much pain. Whereas endophthalmitis, you know, we were taught it occurred 4 to 7 days after cataract surgery. Nowadays, it's out to 9, even 13 days after cataract surgery. And endophthalmitis, 75% of them will have pain. They'll have anterior segment inflammation. They'll have vitreous involvement. They'll have corneal edema still, but not the diffuse edema you see with TAS, and it is due to a bacterial infection. Although the hard part is when you do cultures in endophthalmitis, you know, up to a third of all cultures are negative, so you have to go on the clinical history.
You discussed the
Well, the prognosis depends, and in terms of TAS, it depends on the severity of the insult that causes the TAS. And so, you know, TAS, if you've got a severe insult, if they put something inside the eye that is extremely toxic by mistake, we've seen patients who will actually require cornea transplants or desect. They'll require a glaucoma valve because they'll have severe glaucoma afterward. They'll have the sequelae of chronic inflammation like cystoid macular edema, so they can have severe problems with TAS. Fortunately, most cases are either mild to moderate, and they will clear usually on the order of a couple of weeks to a couple of months. Endophthalmitis depends on how rapidly it's recognized and, again, on the virulence of the bacteria. If it's the most common bug, which is a staph epidermidis, then, you know, chances of visual recovery, if it's caught soon enough and treated properly, are pretty good. If it's a different type of bug, if it's a strep or gram-negative, or even another gram-positive bug, then the prognosis is quite guarded, and it can be very bad.
Dr. Ramos, can you share what we're doing as far as texting nurses in the OR? I mean, sterilizing our instruments, making sure everything's sterile, and we're doing everything right. Short of doing that, is there anything we can do to prevent TAS or endophthalmitis?
Boy, that's about a 45-minute conversation, and we'll get into that.
Either Dr. Crandall or Dr. Ambadi, do one of you guys want to talk about what you commonly do in your bilateral patients to reduce the risk of endophthalmitis or TAS happening on both sides?
Well, I think endophthalmitis, unless it's an endogenous endophthalmitis, each eye is a separate eye. So, you know, it's one in 2,000, and it's one in 2,000 would be the risk. But TAS is a different story. So I always assume that the TAS is a high probability. So what we do is we use no lots that are the same. So the BSS lots are different. We have them make up separate intraocular solutions. They're all different. So the lidocaine, the epinephrine come from different lots from the pharmacy. Each eye is, and I do suture the eyes, by the way, because if one of the thoughts of endophthalmitis high risk is a poor wound. Most wounds are self-sealing, but I don't take a chance on the bilaterals and do them that way. And then, even the viscoelastics that go in the eye, I use different viscoelastics in each set of eyes. We also assume possibility of reaction, so we use, whenever we can, paraben-free. Everything's free. Our gloves are different, the two different eyes. So I think that we've never had a case of TAS that I know of in any of my bilaterals. Before we get going, I'm curious why you took the bilateral kids out of the concept, because I think it still is a bigger risk in them as it is, because actually the surgery is more aggressive in them than as adult. And I worry about do the exact same thing on the kids. I think we do that, and it's considered quote unquote norm. And I'm not sure where the
Is it because of anesthesia? I mean, I think that's most people's assumption.
It is because
the anesthesia risk is greater.
Risk is greater than the risk for doing it.
Right.
But nevertheless, I do know that there are pediatric. And Bob's not. I don't know if Hosman's here. Are any peds guys here? I do know that there are peds guys in the United States that will not do bilateral.
Right.
Because of the fear of that, and I think that. So I don't.
I agree
with that, but I think that there's. Still should be part of the equation.
Great point. Dr. Ambadi, is there anything else that you routinely do for your bilateral cases that we haven't discussed?
No, I agree with what Alan has said. Treat every eye as a separate eye in different lots and different drapes and reprep the eye and everything.
I will say that also that some people that do these, what they'll do is they'll take the patient out, bring another patient in, do another case, and then bring the patient back in.
Okay.
To me, that's what OSHA does. To me, that doesn't make a lot of sense. But
does that alter any of the reimbursement considerations?
No.
And then what about from the anesthesia standpoint? I don't know.
Anesthesia gets screwed too. Yeah. So does the hospital.
Yeah. So that's actually, I mean, in the discussions in the literature, the financial impact is much worse on anesthesia than it is on the surgeon.
Actually, I think the hospital takes the biggest hit.
Really?
I might be wrong. Is Laurel here? Anybody from? Okay, but that I think numbers-wise, the hospital takes the biggest
50% for everybody. Yeah. Now, one last point here that we're going to bring up when you're talking about cons before we delve into this is legal issues. And in the United States, it's different than in Canada and different than in other parts of the world. But legal issues are something you got to put in a con. And whenever you're out in front of the standard accepted practice in, you know, in a field, you worry about potential legal issues. And so, you know, if indeed you had an outbreak of TAS in your facility and one of the patients was a bilateral patient, the lawyers will jump all over that, saying that was a standard accepted care. And so we have to be very careful. And I know Randy and I were working on the American Academy's preferred practice plan for cataracts. You have to be very careful, because if you make one statement about, you know, the risk involved there and make it sound like that's not an acceptable risk, the lawyers will jump on that immediately. And I've had lawyers, when I was an expert witness, quote the ophthalmology Times.
Oh, absolutely.
And so you have to be careful. That's the shiny tabloid thing that we get, that's the Inquirer that we get every month. And so they will quote that, and so we have to be very careful when we're doing things like putting out position papers for society or putting out papers for our field, that we don't make quotes like that. We make it clear that, you know, under certain circumstances, this is an acceptable way of doing things, because if not, the lawyers will jump all over it. And again, a rare, you know, TAS is a very rare thing. I mean, the incidence is anywhere from 0.03 to 0.07%, but still, if you have somehow a bad material used that day and you do get bilateral TAS, the lawyers are just going to jump all over that.
Right. Now, the preferred practice pattern you talk about was just in October 2011 or the fall.
Yes.
So, correct me if I'm wrong, is that the first time that the Academy preferred practice pattern has mentioned a relative indication for simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery?
So it was mentioned the previous one, but it was generally pretty negative. And so this go around, it's listed cautiously again. I mean, Nick's absolutely correct. Having done a lot of defense work, they don't quote all your peer-reviewed articles. They'll quote every quote that's ever happened in the throwaways, of which, you know, there's hundreds and hundreds. And they'll quote something back from, you know, well, what do you think of this, Dr. Olson? Well, you said that in 1979.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I don't even remember that I reviewed it. And who knows if they quoted me accurately. So.
Right.
So the new one makes it clear that that this has changed, and it makes it clear that there is controversy, but that if people do the kinds of things that you know, Alan and Bob have talked about, that you treat it as though it's a totally separate case, then certainly that there are indications in people who feel so. They wanted to make sure that this wasn't a priori a legal opinion saying you shouldn't be doing.
Right.
So that's the change that you'll see in this new regulation. But it also lists all the caveats and all the concerns.
Yeah. Right, right. Great.
But the other two other cons are, number one, a patient could end up bilateral with one. And it's the related con is you'd have to live with that. You'd have to go on. You'd have to be able to go on with your career knowing that that happened. And that and you would be on all the front pages.
So that's the gut, that's the one that you know that often sits there as people consider this the bilateral complication. Having had a patient who I operated on not at the same time differently go bilaterally blind from expulsive hemorrhages, I can tell you it is an awful thing. Corneal transplants expulsed both eyes and ended up bilaterally blind. So I can tell you that can happen. It can happen in other ways, and it's an awful thing. Judith, just before you go, I just want to point out that I think that the evidence, and there's a whole society, Nick and I were with Steve Arshinoff when we were speaking at a UCLA meeting in which we were literally badgered by him for a period of time. We figured out how we could escape his wrath, because he is so on this. And he's head of the society. And I wrote an editorial for Canadian Journal of Ophthalmology. I think all of the different things we've talked about have largely rendered that not much more of a complication, because you also have that risk, maybe 1 of 4 million or so, by doing different periods of time that you could get a complication. If it's a 1 in 2,000 and 1 in 2,000 the other, mathematically, eventually, you know, that's going to catch up with you and happen. But the one that would concern me the most still is the TAS, because even though you can have different lots of the rest, we've certainly had examples where a company has provided a product where everything is bad. And I'll never forget the one I remember. One of our former fellows called me up, had 17 cases he'd done the day before, and every case the next day was hand motion divisions. And many of which went on to have severe complications. And I will admit that there's nothing you could have done to avoid that in regards to, but it's certainly not something that if done sequentially, I mean, once it happened once, I mean, they go on and it turns out that this there was a fly-by-night company and they just plain had the pH off on everything, didn't matter what lot you had. And he didn't even know that his ambulatory surgery center had gone for the, you know, take a chance ink, you know, to grab a new balanced salt solution. So extremely low risk, but that's the one that if it happens, it tends to happen to everybody, is that epidemic thing. And Nick certainly had plenty of examples. And is that enough to warrant not considering this because it is a rare overall event to have that happen or not? I mean, that's where, you know, it comes down to kind of gut time on this. And Judith, sorry.
I think you're right on that. First of all, you can't do the second eye unless the first eye goes perfectly. There's absolutely no question about that. Okay. The second thing is I do change my technique. You know, usual cases 6-7 minutes. We use a low flow technique. We're using different agents in each eye. So I think your chances of getting bilateral ischemic optic neuropathy. Have you ever seen that in a case?
I don't think I've ever seen somebody have.
And by the way, we see him that day twice, so we watch for pressure spikes. There are lots of subtle things that are different.
That's a very good point, and that's the category of patients that we have to be real careful about, is because there's a clear type of patient that's not good or not a good patient for simultaneous bilateral cataract surgery, and it's a patient who, for whatever reason, you anticipate, and these may be unanticipated in some situations, but if you anticipate that they're at a higher risk for those early postoperative events or even intraoperative complications, pseudo-X, IFIS, small pupil, then those may be patients that are better to do sequential, you know, different day cataract surgery.
Certainly. And certainly. You know, I sound like Tevian on Fiddler on the Roof, but on the other hand, it's interesting. Steve Arshinoff, who Randy mentioned, he's a surgeon from Canada who started this group doing simultaneous bilateral surgeries, is very strident about this. I mean, like, in-your-face strident, but they're tracking their data pretty carefully, and you know, every time I hear him, they add another 100,000 cases. I mean, it's something like 150,000 cases without any endophthalmitis or any problem. And so the numbers are telling us that you know, the risk of complication is exceedingly low. He had a epidemiologist look at some things, and to put it in perspective, they found that the odds of having bilateral endophthalmitis were lower than the odds of getting killed in an automobile accident driving to two separate surgeries. So seriously, I mean, this is the kind of things that they look at, and they said, okay, if you're going to have two separate surgeries, someone has to drive you back and forth, and you have to go to the surgery and the follow-ups, and the chance of dying in an automobile accident were actually higher than getting bilateral endophthalmitis. So you want to put this in a perspective. Now, that's not going to mean anything, again, in a court of law, but that's the extent they'll go to defend this. Yeah.
So, my position has already been well written. Put together, I did that editorial for Canadian Journal of Ophthalmology specifically for Steve Arshinoff's paper that he had there. And I think that doing all the things that people talked that has become unacceptable, and it's something that people certainly consider. But I'm just going to list a series of things that I've seen happen in patients. They're not devastating, but they're something I would like to have known that I wouldn't have known if I had done sequential surgery. So the one thing, obviously, is that unusual pressure spike. Having dealt that with, there's some people who just seem really, and so I do it a little differently the next time around. I mean, I definitely will give a miotic the second time, for instance. So, I mean, that would have been nice to know. Another complication that you would see that you'd like to know is that there are some people who are extremely sensitive, get cystoid macular edema, comes on early on, and I do treat them completely differently in regards to that, if they've had that particular response. Here's another one that I see, and this is way more common than anything else we're talking about. There are people who you put a lens in who just have overwhelmingly severe pseudophakic dysphotopsia, and they're unhappy from moment one, particularly when you're talking premium intraocular lenses. Well, I'd want to know that before you want to go ahead and do the second eye with them. And some of the unhappiest people I've seen have been bilateral premium intraocular lenses who are really unhappy with both. Well, I think that would be an example of something that would be good to know. And let's see, there was one other. Oh, yeah, even though Alan and I agree completely we're doing immensely better, we still do have refractive surprises.
Oh, sure.
And all the evidence out there of the latest studies show that if you take half the difference between your expected and what you actually get using the second eye, that you do improve your refractive outcome, and don't think that's unimportant. I got somebody suing me right now because she's minus 3/4 of a diopter and feels that she should have been plano in the second eye.
Yeah. But I think all those fall into the category of I would not do the same day type of patients. I wouldn't do somebody that's had previous either LASIK or certainly hyperopic LASIK, because there still is a little bit of a crapshoot on what you're going to pick up. And the pressure spikes, I've really gone to whenever I can doing same-day surgery, because the surprise to me is how many we miss routinely. I see them 6 hours afterwards, their pressures are up, and then the next morning they're down. So I think one of the things that I'm switching is I'm trying to do more and more same-day surgery at 4 to 6 hours, and I'm catching a lot of post-op pressure spikes. So I think that in that subgroup, you could easily catch those. But
so would you say bilateral premium IOLs?
No, I would never do that.
Yeah, I'd be really leery of that, because they're very demanding. And they're more likely to have dysphotopsia.
Well, and there you really have to be within a quarter of a diopter, right? So that's a different ball game. I mean, most of the people that we're doing are like somebody we're taking over the main hospital. We had one or two that are they're so large that they had to lift them up on a truck to put them on the anesthesia cart and put them asleep. I mean, that guy is he's going to die.
Yeah, no. if twice. There's a high risk overall, this is.
Are there any other?
I would like to say one thing. There's one thing you said that I disagree with. I'll get to it. In third world, but they don't do bilateral surgery anymore. There were a couple reports. I think bilateral is very unusual in, at least in my experience. I don't think I've ever done one in the 50 or so missions that we've done with Jeff and. And
do you end up doing the second eye?
We do the second eye, but it's usually next day or 2 days later. But
so that's not a situation where you're doing it to save resources.
No, it's just that's a conscious decision. They're slightly higher risk, we think, than because it's out in the third world. I just have never seen that done. I don't know. I do. We have some folks here from the third world, don't we? Yes. Never. Yeah, unilateral. So I think that comment was wrong.
Apologies. Dr. Kleinschmidt had a comment. Do we have the microphone?
So I'm just wondering about the patient choice and transparency, legality, consent, those sorts of issues.
those conversations are about triple what our normal stuff is. Yeah, I mean, we have to go over everything. That we don't know this, we don't know that.
And so, Charlene, you're looking for somebody who enthusiastically wants this.
Begging.
Dr. Harry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure.
Yeah. The hospital generally will lose money.
They lose money.
Because of the reimbursement and the costs are essentially the same, if we did this as a routine and Medicare doesn't change, we put ambulatory surgery on a hospital without business. That's medical economics, but sadly that is reality.
Dr. Williams.
I was wondering if I was invisible there, Grant. One of the pros that we haven't discussed yet is for some of the patients, particularly some of the VA patients, the travel to and from appointments is a significant difficulty for them. Patients coming down from Montana and stuff who don't have very many financial resources. I feel like some of these guys, you can almost bankrupt them by making them come back three times for one eye and then three times for the other eye. And then another thing that hasn't been mentioned is cost to the healthcare system as a whole. For example, we did bilateral simultaneous cataract surgery on a prisoner this week, and the overall cost savings to the healthcare system with not hiring two guards to come to the Moran twice and so on, are probably quite substantial, and there's some evidence that from a standpoint of reducing the overall healthcare costs of providing cataract surgery, although the hospitals and the surgeon may receive less reimbursement, the total healthcare system spends less.
Yeah, that's a good point. And your point about the vet was, the VA is actually paying for that transportation. So patients who, for example, come to Salt Lake VA from Montana, they fly them down for each visit, and that's, hundreds of dollars for day one, week one. So even if we do, so it's not them that are bankrupting from this, it's all you. And even on those patients when we do sequential surgery, we try to coordinate it, like where we do the second surgery to coincide with their, 2-week post-op appointment or something, but that ends up saving them one visit in the long run. So yeah, simultaneous surgery in those patients would be a benefit for
I'd like to make a couple of points. So some of the vets are paid, some of them are not, depending on their level of service connection. Mm-hmm. But as Nick mentioned, the risk of TAS is about 1 in 3,000, and the risk of endophthalmitis is 1 in 3,000. So the combined risk of those is probably 1 in 1,500, and therefore the risk of bilateral TAS or endophthalmitis is, if you square those, is 1 in 2.25 million.
It's not a square phenomenon. I got to point out that I'll grant you an endophthalmitis. It's not TAS. If you've got everything contaminated, then your risk is still the one. And understand that it's very variable. I mean, there are times and periods when the risk of TAS has been as high as 1%, 0.7 in one, you said. Right. So if you had a bad batch, you can't square that odds. Everybody's at risk for that day.
Everyone's at risk for the day.
That's the and one that you can't square those.
What if you're using different lots and different companies?
If the whole company, like that one company, that everything they did, that their pH is off, everybody. And we've not had one. We've had several of those. It wasn't just a lot. The company just plain missed it. Could be your sterilizer.
Yeah, instrument cleaning and sterilization. Even if you use separate sets of instruments, they're still going to be cleaned and sterilized by the same crew and the same one. And so even though you use completely separate instruments and separate trays, again, the risk of TAS is still there. So
endophthalmitis, I'll grant you it's a square. But TAS, it's not quite, because you're right, some are individual, but there are clearly many examples where if you had it in one, you're going to get it in the other, because every patient got it.
Fair enough.
Does anyone else have any?
I just wanted to carry that forward. The conjugate risk of bilateral TAS is increased in the second eye if the first eye is bad. Fair enough. However, the whole probability as a population still remains 1 in 3,000 or 1 in 2,000, right?
1 in 1,500.
Okay. So I guess my point is the risk of bilateral catastrophic vision loss in a patient with bilateral surgery would approach, I think, if you do the math, 1 in 2 million, something like that. The probability of highway fatalities per highway mile is 1.1 in 100 million miles. And that means if a patient has to travel more than 50 miles for an extra surgery day and two or three extra postoperative visits, that we're increasing the risk of highway fatality over the risk of bilateral catastrophic vision loss. And for someone who's coming from Montana or Wyoming, I think travel burden is significant. And even just overall, last year at JCRS, there was a paper that the cost of healthcare, travel, home care, and lost working time was reduced by $1,150 for patients who had bilateral surgery on the same day. So I think these are not insignificant. Clearly, the precautions that have been mentioned in terms of treating each eye separately are vital. But I think it's important to bear in mind that proper patient selection, where a patient has a travel hardship or is at high risk for general anesthesia, and this is exactly what's in the AAO preferred practice pattern, general anesthesia where travel is a hardship, I think those are significant considerations. As far as the refractive outcome issues, there have been 6 articles published on the use of the first eye refractive outcome on the second, on the refractive precision on the second eye. 4 of those have found benefit, 2 of them did not find benefit. The 2 which were actually clinical trials comparing head-to-head simultaneous versus separated bilateral surgery, which also used modern keratometry instruments, Penicam, those were the 2 that did not find benefit. So I think the refractive error outcome benefit is still not resolved. Certainly when we started doing LASIK 10 or 12 years ago, there were a lot of issues about should we do LASIK on one eye one day and then the second eye the second day, and as the instruments got better and as the refractive precision got better and as the complication risk went down, we went through a very similar evolution where doing bilateral LASIK was became accepted. So I just wanted to raise a few points, and even the 4 studies that showed benefit, it was in the range of use of first eye outcome reduced mean absolute error on the second eye by from 0.47 diopters to 0.41 diopters, and that is significant for the person who has it. But it reduces the spread. Certainly, it reduces the spread. But I just wanted to point out that the literature is not conclusive. That you know, there's 4 in favor and 2 that show no benefit.
So let me respond to that, because I've actually looked at that literature very carefully, and the problem with most of the literature we have on that subject is we take it all comers and looking at all comers, and so you have lots of noise in the system because the majority are going to cluster right near your mean, and so in order to move your mean by the 1 to 2% that are over a diopter and some series as much as 5%. You know, you need huge numbers to have the power to really tell a difference. So the study that really needs to be done, and the ones I'm concerned about, they're not the vast majority of patients. It's those ones that have an error from your outcome of a diopter or more. Mm-hmm. And if you look at that, and if you repower the studies that have been done to suggest that rate's at 2%, those that say there was no difference are underpowered to be able to make that difference because they're looking at all of it. What you really need to compare are those ones we all know where you expect everything fine and like, holy mackerel, this is a diopter and a quarter off. How the heck did that happen? Your biometry's fine, you repeat it. There's lots of reasons, and I think, as I said in the big course lecture, it's the effective lens position and probably posterior cornea are the 2 reasons why that happens. We still don't have a really good way. I mean, I think the posterior cornea, that's really Doug Koch's, I think, big lecture, mm-hmm. is another big area we need to look at. So I think that the 4 studies that showed it, The two that didn't, I think they were underpowered to look at what they were supposed to look at, which is really those outliers. So I'll say that. Now, at the same time, I don't want to come across as that I feel that this is the wrong thing to do. I mean, I wrote the editorial, and I can tell you what's happening internationally is this is a growing phenomenon. Sweden has already made the decision, and Sweden is extremely careful. And that's one system I know extremely well. They have a every cataract gets registered in a national registry. They look at every complication. They know how often a capsule's broken. They know endophthalmitis. They've followed it, and they've got outstanding numbers, much better than our Medicare data that we have, for instance. And they're moving towards this, and there are many places. And I think that right now, the Ligers ASCRS, they're at 15% sequential. So I need to point out that I do think that this is definitely a trend, that you can make arguments going both ways. And so I don't want it to sound like I'm condemning, but I do think that there are valid issues and reasons why you shouldn't feel that like it's the wrong, that not doing it simultaneously. There's plenty of reasons why there are advantages the other way as well.
And we're not saying that everybody should be doing this either. I mean, this is very careful. It has to be a full team effort. You really have to have your pharmacy has to have the capability of separating all these lots, which is sometimes not so easy. And that's that. I think that's also critical. I think anybody that is interested, there is this International Society for Bilateral Cataract Surgery. They meet at the European meeting. I don't know if you guys are going to that meeting. So I'm going to be giving a talk on TAS at that meeting. It's Monday night during European Cataract Society every year. So then you can come and get some info. Yeah. Well, that's why I say that conversation almost doubles the time that we're in there versus the normal, because we go through all of the stuff. You know, one of the biggest problems is what is informed consent. I mean, you don't know how many times I have a patient that we're doing the refraction and they say, so did you really put a little plastic lens in the eye? I mean, they've signed the op report. I mean, and they ask you that, right? And you use the laser, right, to remove it? Yeah, I use the laser, yeah. So it's a real problem. It is a real problem. And in that, we always involve family. One of the things we do is we want someone else to be listening to what we're saying, and then we go over the risks that, you know, if it happens, it's going to happen to both eyes, and it's low, but it's not zero.
Do you have a simulation of what that is? I mean,
well, the best simulation is to have them wear patches on both eyes. We don't do that.
So just real fast, if you want something really fun, talk to your cataract patients the day after surgery and say, well, what do you think went on or what happened? It's hilarious to think, you scraped something off my cornea.
Dr. Mifflin, do you have a comment?
I just have a response to Dr. Hartnett's question. Because refractive surgery is almost always bilateral surgery, this comes up a lot. And, you know, granted, bilateral vision loss with refractive surgery is less common, but it's still possible. I use the analogy of airline travel because I think there are a lot of parallels in a really, really safe industry. But I say, you know, you could be the statistic. The plane could crash, and if it crashes, you know, we know what the outcome is in airline disasters. And patients definitely understand that. They definitely understand that. And I loved Julia's comment. I really think that, you know, putting the patient in control is the way to deal with this issue. It's not unlike any other surgery that we do, you know, in terms of informed consent. There are going to be pros and cons. There are going to be arguments for and against. I think one thing that hasn't been brought up that I think is really important is not everybody wants or needs their second eye done, so there's also resource utilization that, you know, comes into play. We take out a lot of 20, 30 cataracts. I mean, we can call it what we want, but we all know we take out a lot of 20, 30 cataracts. Not everybody needs their second eye done. And certainly in the, you know, the healthcare environment that we're in now, that's going to become more and more of an issue. And a lot of people are perfectly happy after they get their first eye done.
Yeah, good point. You get plenty of people say, no, I'm fine. I don't need the other.
How can I give a patient understanding of what it would be like to experience that? I mean, to be able to give informed consent. You don't want to scare them, mm-hmm. but you know, I mean, these are things that are really difficult. We don't have enough terms in our vocabulary to describe all the things that the visual system does, for example.
Yeah. One thing you might want to do is come on her Saturday and play with her glasses. I've done that. It's pretty damn interesting. You know, the glasses that simulate early glaucoma, late glaucoma, macular degeneration. And it's pretty interesting. The other thing is no matter what we tell patients, their macular degeneration is bad, but you guys can't see and we're going to do the cataract. Every single one of them says, I know you told me, but I was sure I was going to see better reading afterwards. They always say that. And I get on my knees before I say, I'm begging you to tell me right now. You know you're not going to read. Now, I always think they're going to read better. It's very interesting.
Yeah. One thing I wanted to mention was in the process of the conversation in the patient room, anytime someone brings up this issue of can I have both eyes done in the same time, generally my first comments are discouraging. And it's going to be a lot harder that first day. You're going to have time needed for recovery of your vision and going through the risks and so on. And so they really have to want this for whatever reason, travel hardship or faster recovery to get back to their job or whatever the context is. But the initial conversation starts off as the extra challenges and risks with doing it this approach. And then if they really push for it, if it's an appropriate indication, then I think it's reasonable, depending on the patient context, to consider it.
I'm really happy that we've started framing this too in an ethical term. So, you know, allocation of healthcare resources, patient autonomy, informed consent, and we do happen to have an ethical discussion leader here with this. I was hoping Dr. Jacobson would be able to kind of take over from here and discuss some of the issues that we've been struggling with.
Sure. I think it's actually leader of an ethical discussion. And then also, I actually appreciate, some of you may know, I'm actually not leading our Division of Medical Ethics and Humanities any longer. I've stepped aside from that, and my colleague Jeff Botkin is doing that, but I continue to really enjoy opportunities like this. I never fail to learn, and I'm sure you noticed that this is one where the residents, Jeff also played a role in planning this, and I think they're very thoughtful, and I hope they do get to the sort of the follow-up question or poll that they've talked about. One of the things that's rather challenging, I think, in teaching and learning is that we rarely change our opinions. That's actually the case even with science, but I think it's much easier to change an opinion about science after one sees a lot of data. I'm confident that that changes. We rarely change beliefs, however. And it's intriguing about how what does change beliefs. So today it's a fascinating opportunity to think that through. I wanted to share with you what this looks like from the outside a little bit. I think the first thing to say about it is ethical issues are different in every specialty. We've talked about that here. You work in a specialty where you deal with paired organs, which is absolutely fascinating in terms of the way that changes your feeling about risk and even benefit. In some other areas, for example, there's a very similar response to innovation. Basically, what you're looking at here is a new way of doing things. It's not technically so new, but it's new sequentially, and the proximity of doing one to another. People who work on only one organ do not have this issue, but they do have the issue of resisting change. And I think that's really important. A good place to think about that would be in cardiology. And so it's actually the case in every field that as technology develops, there is some technology, for example, that may be instantly more appealing to patients than it is to clinicians. A good example of that would be anything that reduces scars, for example. So just think again about people who work on one organ, and it's very early in the evolution of a new technique, which may be roughly comparable in terms of technical outcome, but which has something that appeals to patients. For example, laparoscopic approaches. And just think about what you know about that and the fact that there's always a learning curve. So from the medical side, moving from open surgery, we'll pick another unpaired organ, the gallbladder, moving from open surgery for the gallbladder to laparoscopic surgery clearly is going to have a trade-off in terms of outcomes, right? For a while, it's very predictable, and some of you spoke about the emotional response of having a very bad outcome. A surgeon learning a new technique is going to have some bad outcomes. Patients were very eager to have laparoscopic surgery, and one of the ways of managing that is, in fact, the ethical technique of dealing with that is sharing the information. This is new. Things that are new have also unexpected consequences, as well as the skill increase that comes with time, or the decreased skill that is there at the beginning and better later. And I think you know from your environment, just watching medicine, how that happens. And you can see, actually, the trail of these things. There were some very severe complications of laparoscopic surgery early because of the techniques not being well understood. On the other hand, it's very hard to tabulate or calculate what are the benefits of smaller scars, right, versus some of those catastrophes. And these things are never easy, because in that procedure, for example, there may be some reduced time that's involved. There may be some reduced trauma to other organs. And so what you have here today, I think, is rather interesting in terms of you're trying to add up pros and cons. Again, from an outside perspective, one of the problems here is that the pros and cons are not the same on both sides. It's just a two-way chart, but you could be thinking pros and cons for physicians as well as pros and cons for patients. And they're not necessarily identical, and they never will be. So I think one of the problems, you know, that's a difference in science is that we tend to look only down one road. If we're only looking at outcome, for example, that's all we're looking at. We're not really thinking about values, preferences, all these other things that might be very important for patients. And this is a classic issue of this kind. As soon as we talk about litigation and cost, we're basically talking about the medical side, right? And they're serious issues. There's nothing trivial there. But that's not an easy thing to balance with, say, travel convenience, because it's not even affecting the same people, let alone not of the same magnitude. So I think it's reasonable to acknowledge what a difficult challenge this is in terms of kind of coming up with some kind of clear bottom line. You know, we add up all the numbers, and then this one comes out favorable, not favorable. That's actually an area where kind of ethical analysis might be relevant. And you've also actually talked a little bit about some of the problems with that. That is, wouldn't it be a lovely world if we actually believed that by laying out risks and benefits, those for us, those for patients, to the patients, and let them make a decision, that that was an informed, fully rational decision? I think that would be very comforting. It's not. But you want to remember that it's not for anything else either. And we operate with that, and what it is kind of the best we can do in terms of sharing that burden. And the better your efforts at informed consent, and we could even talk a little bit about things that work and things that don't, the more likely the consent is actually informed. But the patient's view of a procedure will never be the physician's view. It cannot be. We can't expect that as a standard. So I think even if we're turning to informed consent to balance this, we have to understand that it will never be the same informed consent that we have. I think one of the things that patients are pretty good at is telling you what's important to them. And I think that's something that we could sort of pull up a little bit here, which is, you know, we've heard language like they're begging for this procedure. This is actually a very useful term because it's a signal that this is very important for a patient, but it's worth thinking about why it's so important. And one of the reasons for that is that you can then negotiate some of that terrain. So for example, somebody may talk about a planned event that they want to get to and they want to have both eyes, right, ready for that, and so it will all be perfect. Well, interestingly enough, just in a discussion about possible risks and benefits that are medical, it's possible the event might actually change schedule. That is, you know, faced with the idea that instead of having both eyes ready to go, the patient could actually be bilaterally blind at that event. Not a very likely possibility, but patients also vary in terms of their ability to tolerate risk. Many of us are starting to think this is kind of congenital. Some of us are more risk averse, some of us are not. You might think about that in terms of where your classmates win in medicine, right? The ones that are doing airborne surgery. But people are like that as well. And so for some people, analogizing what the risk might mean would actually cause them to change their mind.
Yeah. Alan? You know, it's interesting, as a patient, recently I had a knee done, my left knee total. And lots of questions came up. So the first question that I heard from many patients is, once I had the first leg done, I never had the other one done. It hurts the damn bad. Okay. And then I heard others say, I do it bilateral, then you only go through the pain once. So I was talking to my surgeon, I said that. He said, well, here's your choices. If you do them both on the same day, you're going to be out of work 8.5 straight weeks minimum. If you let me do them sequentially, I can get you back to work in 3 weeks each time, saving 2.5 to 5 weeks of work. So I chose one knee, because I want to work. But that's a decision that I made. But it hurts like hell. I'm not looking forward to the next one, I tell you.
I hear you. But
Jay, can I just make
absolutely.
One comment?
Sure, Randy.
Actually, on that, I and Bala, this is interesting, because I mentioned to a patient who wanted bilateral surgery, and I pointed out, you know, that there's a small risk of blindness. And I said, but you should know, because I quoted that you probably, this is a person in Wyoming, you probably have a greater risk of dying in a car accident going bilaterally blind. His response, I'd rather die in a car accident than be bilaterally blind.
I think those are actually both interesting examples, and they help us think about things because, you know, these are physicians, but both sharing things that come from a patient perspective. And those are not unimaginable things to hear, that for some people, going back to work earlier might be more important than some pain. And for other people, there are things worse than bilateral blindness and vice versa. So I think that conversation may actually help us a good deal as we're considering a procedure like this, because it's just one more way in which patients are different. They're different in terms of their intraocular pressures, their underlying diseases, et cetera, but their values preferences are very different. One of the things that I heard the group talking about, and again, these are outside perspectives, and some of them for me are epidemiologic, and that is that the idea of related risk and unrelated risk in the two most feared complications. One of the fascinating things, I think, about thinking about a patient where you're doing bilateral or sequential, which is a better name, is that the risk of ophthalmitis actually doesn't change by that. If that's operator dependent, for example, then you do the first eye at 9 o'clock and the second eye at 11. In each case, the risk is there. And that would also be true today and 3 months from now. Oddly enough, because of the epidemic phenomenon of TAS, if you do the first eye on a day when the solutions are okay, there's actually no risk to the next eye. That is, isn't that fascinating that it's only one for that day, right? Whereas when you do them sequentially, each day has the statistical risk of TAS. The other one is about our emotional response to events. And again, because you take care of two eyes and you're so concerned with blindness, it's not just one, it's one plus one, it's actually the disorder that you fear the most. In a sense, blind is both eyes, right? If it's only one eye, you're not fully blind. And so the consequence is only associated with the two eyes. The TAS problem is a fascinating one. I think what you're all kind of talking about, and you talk about litigation, is actually not so much what the rules are of malpractice or what a judge might instruct the jury to do, but rather how a jury might feel faced with a case with this terrible outcome. So let's talk about TASS for just a minute in the same way that we talked about, you know, days to work or pain. So it could be the case that on one day, 17 people were affected. That's just the way that works. And we don't control that. We don't do only one operation a day. We actually live with the idea that on any day, there could be that phenomenon in the OR, and 17 might be a low number for many ORs. So then think about that in the courtroom setting and from the emotional side, which, let's just make you an economist for a moment and not an ophthalmologist. Would the economist be more worried about the one patient with two eyes on a day when there were 15 other patients, or would he be most worried about a day where you did 20 cases versus 10? Because on any day, the more cases that you do, the more aggregate risk there is for an epidemic that would occur to everybody that day. So it's just another way to think about that. And I think there's no question that for the patient, the experience has to be worse to lose vision in two eyes rather than one.
No comparison. I mean, a one-eyed patient amazingly has, in many ways, full function. There's a difference. I mean, Julia, I mean, it isn't exactly the same, but we're not talking that a one-eyed patient has half the function. So if let's say if bilateral vision, you gave it a number of a million, one-eyed vision is still probably 900,000, 850,000, and bilateral blindness, all of a sudden, then it goes to zero. And so, I mean, there's a dramatic difference in regards to those two different scenarios.
That's great. I'll do one thing and then you go back to it. So, I think the other one that began to come up here, and it's always invisible for us when we talk about risk, is what the alternative risks are. And we actually were talking about driving. Right? Mm-hmm. But during the period of time between one eye and another, if that reaches into weeks or months, that's of course not the only risk. You actually want to think about the other things that happen to people during that time, some of which may actually equate with the problem of bilateral blindness. I'll just think about that with you a little bit. What's the average age of the patient that you do cataracts in? 60, 70 is what I've heard. So what you want to think through there is that the life expectancy at 70 is approximately 10. It's actually longer than that. So you want to think about that. So there are 3,650 days left in that person's life expectancy, right? So the chance of dying, if they're all going to die within that time, if you want to, you could put that as a numerator and a denominator. And it's fascinating. It's around 1 in 3,000. Which is somewhere close to the kind of risk that you've been talking about. So it's fascinating to think that in the interval between one eye and another, many things could happen. An automobile accident, a stroke, a sudden death, a malignancy, a whole host of other things that in a way would end a life where there'd be no vision at all, right? So again, psychologically, what we've thought through is that the worst thing, because it is us, one of the worst things we could imagine is somehow being linked to bilateral blindness in a patient. But think about that perspective from a patient's perspective. That's one risk in informed consent you'll talk about today to them. But quite honestly, many of them already know. There are many other risks in their life. Right? They know that from their family. They know when their parents died. They know the other things they're all having. And so for them, perhaps it seems odd to us, you know, that the convenience, which is the way I think we would frame it, the convenience of having this done and taking that risk seems inappropriate. But we're not in their life, right? And so we're not exposed to the other risks that they're inevitably exposed to as well. So again, just a very useful thing to think about in terms of the context of the patient. And there's something the panel and you could help me out with a little bit, which is the risk of falling, which is huge in this population. And so it seems like a very relevant one because it speaks to vision. So maybe we could just hear a little bit about that. Is there any argument kind of for or against sequential versus delayed in terms of reducing the risk of falling?
Yep.
I think on the day of surgery, if someone is having both eyes done, they need a lot of support, and that's very important that they have family around them to take care of them and so on. However, the longer it takes for them to recover both eyes vision, the more the probability, I think, of events that you describe. When you have one eye working well and the other eye is not, there's an image mismatch, there's loss of stereopsis in that interval between the two eyes. Patients often do complain that their proprioception or stereopsis is not good in that intervening time. Yeah. Further, they often get confused by their drop schedules. When one eye is done and then the second eye, they often get confused, you know, what drops do I use in which eye at what frequency? And that seems trivial to us, but it's actually not trivial to them. So those are some other factors to consider. Thank you for bringing those up.
Sure. You know, a good example of this, say that the patient who's got bilateral cataracts who's like a -5 myope. You know, they're nearsighted. So you do one eye, and then during the interval between the 2 weeks when you do the two eyes, one eye is highly nearsighted, one eye is not. You can't wear strong glasses in front of one eye, nothing in front of the other eye, and so their depth perception is off. They have increased risk of falling. So in that setting, on one hand, again, here we go, and on the other hand, mm-hmm. On one hand, you would say doing that bilaterally simultaneously, you'd give them both equal vision, you decrease that risk. But then again, in that patient population for the retina people here, they have a slightly higher risk of retinal detachment. So again, you're putting them at risk of a retinal detachment in each eye. So again, you got to balance it on the teeter-totter and see where that's going to play out.
So I think that's really very helpful for me also to hear that about the falling story. And for some patients, again, that's much more important than others. Mm-hmm. And the context may be terribly important. Their home situation, where they live, what they do, all of those things I think are worth talking about. Greg, I think, has planned a couple of other questions for you, including the follow-up. If we wind up having a couple of minutes, if you're interested, there's actually a lot of work that's been done on informed consent. So if, for example, one of your background concerns is that people can't possibly understand what we're talking about, we could have a conversation about some things that have been shown to improve that. So we'll just hold that in abeyance for a minute. And Greg, do you want to pick up with some of your questions?
I'd actually just plan to leave this up in the background. People are already voting while we're going, so. Like I said, I knew people were going to be messing around on their phones anyway, so we'll just give them something to do that's constructive. But yeah, feel free. With this part is done, so we can just vote while we're talking.
Sure, thank you. Well, I think Greg had another very good idea here, because I think notice how subtly things change when the context is a family member. That is, we begin to think about things. We haven't asked the question of, you know, what you might prefer. And I think a relevant question might even be, and which surgeon would you ask to do it? That is, this is an evolving technique. If you were going to have bilateral, who would you have do bilateral sequential? So they're very important points. And if I remember, the distribution here is a little bit different than what we were seeing before, which was, you know, the idea that rare might dominate as an indication for this. So let's talk a little bit about informed consent for just a minute. You all have a lot of experience with it. And by the way, one of the best experiences are things that we've already heard from the panelists, and that is you do informed consent, and then you do a follow-up question. And think about what you're measuring there. You're measuring comprehension. You're also measuring memory, right? And they're very different elements. And so you would understand that. If you asked content about informed consent 6 or 7 years after a procedure, I don't think you'd even be too concerned that people had forgotten some of the details. What's rather shocking is how quickly people do seem to forget or to misunderstand. What have you found is helpful? First one is, it's a great exercise anybody can do, which is the day after your procedure, to just review with the patient what they recalled you saying and what their understanding was. Let me just mention that you don't need to wait for the day after the procedure. And that's actually one of the more important things, is that if you're shocked the day after, right, how would you feel if you got that answer the day before? So the point of doing it the day before is that it actually reveals where the knowledge deficits are or the lack of understanding. I mean, it may seem humorous to us that people have really missed it by a mile, but we're actually far better off knowing that the day before than we are the day after. So what's the best way to ask people, how well they understood what you said.
Well, Jay, just to put it in context, there was a study done several years ago that, to me, just really shocked me in informed consent. They came up with 10 simple questions on the level of a fourth grader and gave it to the patient, went over each question with them, went over it with a family member, gave them a copy, said, read this, we're going to quiz you next time you come in. So they actually went over with it, told them, know this, we're going to quiz you on it. They came back and the response rate was about 20%. Now this is not just your routine consent. This is where they took the time and went over it question by question and said they were going to be examined, and the response was 20% correct. 20% and 20% knew it correctly. And so with our routine consent, it's going to be even less than that. So that was a stunning study when I saw that. A
couple of examples. And again, it's always good to go out and get material that either support or refutes our assumption. I think many physicians for a long time have made the assumption that people, quote, don't get it. And I don't know what the questions were, but I think that's helpful to know. So looking, maybe another way to say it is, what's the worst thing you can do to estimate somebody's comprehension of what you've said?
Not asking.
So not asking at all, that must be the worst, because I think we'd all agree, it doesn't take a big study, that not asking, you have zero idea of their level of comprehension. And since that's going to be distributed, somewhere there's somebody who actually understands 100% of what we've said, right? And somewhere there's somebody who understands zero. The point of the study is it gives us kind of an average. But if you don't ask, it could be that it's 100%, but it could be zero, right? But you have no information at all. So that's a problem. At the end of informed consent, not inquiring or evaluating is, now that we all know how poor it is, it's actually almost a second mistake on our part. What would be another poor way of evaluating comprehension? It's one that we do quite often. So that's actually, you hear this a lot. There are two phrases that you hear quite a bit. Do you understand? The other one is, do you have any questions? And we like that because we like answering questions. I mean, that's kind of our role as the expert. But it's not, the psychologists and social scientists find that that's a very poor way for a couple of reasons. One is, people like you and they appreciate the time that you've spent, especially if you spent a lot of time. There's a paradox. If you spend a lot of time and then you say, do you have any questions, they're very disinclined to say so because they feel that reflects badly on you. It's not a good choice. Let me get a comment here and then here. Go ahead.
Jay, I just wanted to, that's a very subtle distinction. So I almost never ask, do you have any questions? I think the better question to ask is, what questions do you have? And inviting the patient to come forward. And that opens the door. Anytime you say, do you, very often the response, as you say, is no. And when you say, what questions do you have, they're much more likely to ask you stuff.
So just a quick comment. Again, it's a terribly subtle distinction. But when you say, what questions do you have, perhaps the assumption is, he thinks I have questions. Another way of framing that is, even though we've spent a lot of time together, most patients still have questions. Or I know I haven't addressed all patients' questions. So if you flip it around that the question actually is what you expect rather than a judgment on your adequacy, probably do make it better. Yeah.
Health literacy is a big factor here. If what we present to the patient isn't crystal clear, they won't have any questions. So we have to be aware of that all the time. When you say you have a secondary membrane that will yag you and you'll be a lot better. And I hear that.
Well, it's another wonderful insight about what it takes to have a question. It's often the story that, first of all, we don't understand when we misunderstand. Most of us don't recognize that. But we need to understand something, usually, to have more questions about it. So we'll wrap up here in sort of a short time. The things that help the most, and I think we heard it today, are the idea of asking the patient to explain to you what it is they understand. That helps a great deal, and it's very reassuring. Sometimes it comes out accurately. You can feel good about that. If it doesn't, the point about literacy is very helpful. Sometimes it's because we use some vocabulary that was just ambiguous. They were guessing. They may not know the distinction between cornea and cataract, and so they went with what they knew. And your knowing that gives you a second chance to either use another word or to do a drawing. So that's very, very helpful. aside from questions, a very nice question that you can ask empathetically is about fear. And the reason that's so useful is that it will help you unpack some of the values that are driving patients either toward or away from the procedure. And that's one where if you frame it again as it helps me to know what people are most afraid of, that's a very inviting way of asking. So fears are good. Is there another comment? Yes.
I don't bring it up unless they bring it up. The only reason I would bring it up is if there's an issue of general anesthesia and some additional risk from that.
So just a background about the conversation and what's in it. Let's say I had an administrator once who said, what gets measured is what gets done. The other thing is about what's incentivized. So you might just imagine, and there's actually one of the articles that was shared, that in the future it might actually be the case that
Sweden.
People would
it's
not.
Incentivized now.
So it's incentivized in Sweden, and I would imagine that it is discussed often in Sweden.
Absolutely.
So I think, again, things to think about here about what we put on the table and who are they for, really rather interesting, and we invite ourselves to spend more time, I think, if we put that on the table now. But you do want to think about that in terms of who is that for? Is that for the patient or for us? We need to wrap up here pretty close. Yeah.
I was just going to reply to Bryce. It's been my experience at the VA. I mean, it's where we primarily talk to our patients about cataract surgery, not necessarily here. But most people are surprised to find out that we don't do both eyes on the same day. In my experience, I have to come back for the second. Or usually they actually think they're coming for the surgery that day when they come to clinic. But if we get over that burden, the next hurdle is they think they're going to have both eyes on the same day.
So I just want one of it's yeah. Even funnier than that is that they'll come in and they have such an idea it's simple and you do your slit lamp exam and I've had them say, did you just do my cataract surgery?
That's actually kind of a note. We may get to that point. In fact, the surgeons who use Versed actually have that question all the time. Did you just do my case? Thank you all very, very much. I think one of the things to keep thinking about in terms of informed consent is that there are people who are achieving better outcomes in terms of recall and understanding. It's not easy, but they shape their presentation based on lots of interviews with people who they've asked this question, what do you understand? Once you have a sense of how people commonly misunderstand, it's much easier to deal with that in your explanation. So my guess is in a year or two, this whole procedure may look very, very different. And I'll just share with you that it's been my pleasure to watch, for example, how reluctant doctors were, for example, to do lumpectomies. I want to think about that in terms of another situation with two organs. But doctors felt for the longest time that it would be in the patient's best interest to do radical breast surgery, right? They believed that, they continued to believe that, but patients actually drove them largely by their perception and a sense of convenience. That was a big driver. But at the end of the day, it's actually worked out well for everybody. So thank you very, very much, and we'll see you again in half a year.
Oh, yeah. I know she was doing it.